Welcome to the Becoming Superhuman podcast, where we interview extraordinary people to bring you the skills and strategies to overcome the impossible. And now, here's your host, Jonathan Levi.
Before we get started, I want to ask you, what would it mean for you to be able to double or even triple your memory and ability to learn? So many people tell us that this skill would be absolutely life-changing for them, but they just don't have the time. They just don't have the time. So that's why we have developed, my team and I, a 5-day memory mastery crash course where we go into all the fundamental neuroscience and the actual techniques that are used by the world's best memory athletes and world record holders. It's a course that we value at $97, but here's the thing. We are actually giving this course away completely for free. All you have to do to enroll in the course is visit jle.vi/5. That's jle.vi/5. Greetings, super friends, and welcome to this week's episode of the Becoming Superhuman podcast. Hey, I want to remind you, if you haven't taken a moment to leave us a review on iTunes or Stitcher, please go ahead and do so because it makes us oh so happy. On to today's episode. You guys, today I am joined once again by Jeff Sanders. He's a keynote speaker and the author of The 5 a.m. Miracle, which we spoke about last time, and The Free Time Formula. He's also the host of The 5 a.m. Miracle podcast, which has ranked number one in iTunes in self-help and business and has been nominated for 6 podcast awards, as well as exceeding 6 million downloads. That is a very impressive number, let me tell you, from one podcaster to another. As you guys know, Jeff and I see eye to eye on very, very many things, productivity and beyond. So this is a wide-ranging and casual conversation. We talk about Jeff's latest book. We talk about the anxiety and stress breakdown that led to writing that book. And we get into some philosophical questions about what the point is and why you should free up your time and why you should not free up your time. I really enjoyed the conversation, which is a pretty good indication that you will really enjoy the conversation. So without any further ado, let me present to you my super friend, Mr. Jeff Sanders. Mr. Jeff Sanders, welcome back, my friend. How are you?
I'm doing very well. Thank you.
Awesome. Awesome. Congratulations on the newborn. That's very, very exciting.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, she's a lot of fun.
Yeah, I imagine. And you're already used to waking up at 5 a.m. So this is like no problem, right?
Yeah, it's interesting because 5 a.m. is, you know, that has been my wake up time. But then when you have a baby that's awake at, you know, midnight and 2:30 in the morning and 4:30 in the morning, it's like, well, 5 a.m. is kind of painful now. So,
right. It's funny. I was reading Benjamin Spall's book because he's a past guest on the show as well. And he quoted Dave Asprey as saying, "It's important to note that the morning routines of parents and non-parents are inherently very different." That was really, really funny. So since we last spoke, you have put out another book.
Yes. Yeah.
Tell us everything you've been up to.
Yeah, my latest book is called The Free Time Formula, and it came out in February of this year. And that book was spawned from kind of a crazy event in my life where I got myself super busy and stressed out and had what basically amounts to a ridiculous panic attack, went up in the hospital, and then realized I had to change the way that I was living because I was a little too ambitious, scheduling myself a little too much. Mm-hmm. And so I backed up a lot of the way that I scheduled my life and figured out how to have more balance. And so my latest book really addresses free time from the perspective of having the margin you need, not just to watch more Netflix or to lay on the couch, but to spend more time with rejuvenation and becoming your best self in a way that's healthy long term.
I really love that. And I love that you share that because I went through a very similar thing about 3 months ago. And I have only recently started talking about it because I've only recently started coming out of it. But I had a pretty massive kind of anxiety breakdown and started having all kinds of manic thoughts. And fortunately for me, Benjamin Hardy pointed out to me and helped me understand, like,
that my stress inventory was like 454 points. And if you're at or above a 300, you have an 80% chance of having a mental or physical breakdown. So it's like, you're not broken. You're just overscheduled and overcommitted, and you're planning 5 million different things. So, you know, it's kind of one of these law of attraction things that ever since I had this experience, I feel like every entrepreneur I talk to either has gone through it the way that I did and the way that you obviously did, or is on the brink of going through it and needs to be told, whoa there, do you really need to do all that right now?
And that's a hard thing to hear if you're going through it, because I know that when I was, you know, overscheduling myself, you know, I was opting into all of these different projects and goals and things I wanted to achieve. And even though I could look at my calendar and see that I was probably too busy, like the other side of my brain just said, well, just drink more coffee and push through, you
right.
know, just be the entrepreneur you think you are and like be this badass and go do it. But at the same time, it's like, that's not a healthy response. Like I need a way to acknowledge what's going on in real time to assess, you know, if this is a healthy balance or not. And if you haven't had a breakdown yet, it's hard to know when it's going to show up because you don't know what the signs are yet. Like I can see it now in myself so much more because I get what led up to that event. So I can, you know, kind of preempt that and change before it happens again. But if you haven't had that breakdown yet, you may not know what your own personal signs are.
Totally. Totally. So tell me how you went about crafting free time, because I know for a lot of people, busy is a badge that they wear on their shoulders. Like we all love to brag about how little we sleep. We love to brag about how busy we are because let's face it, it makes us feel really important. It makes us feel like our lives have meaning and purpose to be busy. So how did you go about, first off, fighting that social norm, but also where were the places where you earned back your time?
It's a great question, because I think that when I was going through kind of my like reinvention of how I use my time, what I noticed was that, you know, that was true about me, that I did wear that badge of honor of busyness equating to productivity. So I thought that the more that was on my calendar, you know, the more effective I was, or the more I could brag about, you know, how much I was getting done. But then when I really assessed like what were those things on my calendar that I was so, you know, impressed by with my own work, and I realized that a large chunk of what I had scheduled were things that I now consider to be nonsense. And I define nonsense in the book as things that never have to get done. And I realized that I had scheduled a ton of stuff that, though they might be good things, if they happen, that's wonderful, but they don't actually have to get done for me to achieve the goals I've set for myself or my business. And so once I realized that, I had this kind of epiphany that, you know, let's say I have 20 tasks on my calendar, but only 4 of them actually mean anything to me. And the other 16 are literally things I could just never do. That's when I reassessed my calendar and said, well, let's cut that stuff. Let's not do any of that and see how that plays out for me. And so now my schedule looks really underbooked. Like you look at my calendar today, you're like, Jeff, do you have a job at all? Like, what do you do all day? But that's intentional, because I know that life throws at me all kinds of opportunities or distractions or other things. And I know that if I walk into my week with too many things on the calendar, it's not going to end up the way that I want it to. And I'm going to end up doing all kinds of things that literally never have to happen.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And you know, there's two things that I really, really love about that. The first one is I've been really obsessed with this idea of the Eisenhower decision matrix, or the Eisenhower quadrants. And this idea that things that are quote unquote important are not urgent, and things that are quote unquote urgent are seldom important. And it took me a long time until someone pointed it out to me that, you know, I thought that because I was doing things that had to get done today, that meant that they were important. But the reality of the matter is, like, a lot of the stuff that we think is urgent just isn't really that important. Like, you can ignore emails and you can ignore group messages and you can ignore a lot of things to focus on the things that are very important but are never going to jump out at you. You know, your long-term strategic plan is never going to jump out at you. Spending time with your loved ones is never going to jump out at you until it does. And I've just been really obsessed with that idea. And the other thing is, you know, I believe it's Dan Sullivan who always says, an entrepreneur who is too tightly scheduled can't transform anything.
Yeah, that's good. I think that's true too. It's like the more that we try to do, the more that we kind of put that pressure on ourselves, the less effective we are. You know, I know that for me, when I have the biggest breakthroughs, when I achieve the most, and then the bigger picture sense, I'm doing fewer things. And I'm investing more of my time and energy into a small number of projects and giving my whole self to those things. And that's when I get the return that I want. And honestly, that's what gives me more energy, more creativity. Like, that's when I feel like I'm really living, is when I'm doing less. And it looks like less on paper, and it is actually less in time, but the results are so much better. And that's the way that I'm striving to kind of craft my time now as much as I can to make sure that that's kind of my long-term game plan.
Right. I love that. It reminds me of Ari Mysel, who's a past guest and fellow Genius Network member, whose whole brand is exactly around that idea of like less doing. And dissociating this idea between like how much stuff did I do versus how actually productive and effective I was. I think it was David Heinemeier Hansen who said on our show, you know, that like productivity is not what you do, but what you accomplish. I think that's absolutely true. So what are some of the things that you got rid of?
A number of things that I had going on in my business. Like, I was blogging a lot. I completely just stopped doing that to make my podcast more effective. I was saying yes to a lot of coffee dates with people that I thought were important, that ultimately most of those would go nowhere. I had just random little projects of things I wanted to do to improve my website or to take my academy to another higher level. Like, little things that if they got done, they are probably fine, but that weren't actually helping me to do like a couple of things I really wanted to get done. And so it was really just a question of saying, like, let's say I have 12 different goals I want to achieve this year. Probably only two of them are the ones that if they got done, that would be my core things. So I just said, well, let's do those two things. And when they get done, if they get done this year, then I can think about the rest of it. So a big part of my issue is that I was literally pursuing too many goals at the same time. And a number of those goals were either unimportant or they weren't important enough yet to really warrant my time usage now. And so it's really just about priority, or, you know, the order of which the things get done, to make sure that I can just say yes to what matters now and really be able to like consciously ignore the rest of it for a while and then get to that stuff when it matters. And so a big part of my kind of, you know, patience game now and self-discipline now is telling myself no to all the things I'd like to work on, knowing full well that I can always get to those things later on. And so I have my Evernote checklist built out where I've got all kinds of ideas for later, and I'll just kind of get to those when they matter, but not yet.
I love that. I've often said that no is the most productive word in the English language.
Yes.
And then I recently heard Arianna Huffington. I'm in a very quotable mood, in case you can't tell. I heard an even better quote Joe Polish told me when he interviewed Arianna Huffington. She was like, the fastest way to get things off of your to-do list is to delete them.
Yes.
It's so true. It's so true, though, because I have, you know, 30 different ideas for lectures that would be really wonderful to do in our masterclass, but nobody's asking for them, you know? And so it's like, do I let them sit on me and keep me from other things that people are asking for? Really, really cool. What are some of the like top things? So coffee dates, you said, are you still doing email?
Yeah, email is still an important part of my kind of workflow and how I communicate, but I've been a little bit more intentional about, you know, the times of the day that I'll say yes to email, which mostly means that what I'm doing is I'm scheduling specific focus blocks of time throughout the day where I'll do my important work. And like between projects, I'll check email and I'll make sure that I'm on top of communication in general. But I definitely want to make sure that, you know, when I have a focus block for a project, when I have time set aside to do my, you know, kind of core activity for the day, that during that time, I'm not also kind of in the back of my head checking email and multitasking, looking at Facebook and, you know, finding all those other excuses to not do the work. The real key for me in the last probably year and a half or so has been taking my focus blocks of time very seriously, to the degree that there literally are no distractions when I'm doing what matters most right in front of me. And then what I find in that is how much more work I can get done and the quality improves. And I am more excited to do more of that kind of work. And then the idea of checking email just seems less appealing. Like, I'm less interested in doing that if I can push my next project forward in a focused manner.
100%. And years ago, I switched to the maker manager schedule. So I only do calls, chats, emails, stuff like that on Mondays and Thursdays. And I write on Sundays and Wednesdays. The problem that I'm having right now is I'm in between kind of creative projects, having just finished one and I'm about to embark on another one next week. And the problem is, if you so rigidly schedule that out where it's days are set up, and of course my computer, I'm an extremist, so my computer is set up that if I do anything but write on a Sunday or a Wednesday, it blocks me out. So it's I can't go into our Facebook mastermind community and respond to people, and I just can't do it. So that level of rigidity has kind of come to bite me in the ass to some extent.
Yeah.
So I love the idea of like blocking out half days, because I won't concede, like, email can wait, you know, and social media can wait and stuff like that. But there are situations in which, look, you just can't move forward on a creative project. You want to be able to at least do something. So lately I've been doing a lot of reading.
Yeah, I mean, that makes total sense. I have been kind of one that goes back and forth between a rigid schedule where I have certain boundaries I don't cross, and then I do the exact opposite and have no boundaries at all. And neither one of them work well for me. So I have to find some sort of middle ground where I have rules, but that rules that I intentionally break sometimes. I feel like that gives me the flexibility I need to do what matters, but also having kind of that proactive plan in place to say, I'm definitely going to make time for those few things that matter most, while also feeling that I can be flexible if need be, because I don't tend to function too well if I'm one extreme or the other. So somehow there's a balance in there somewhere.
I love that. I love that. Any other things that you're doing to stay ultra productive and kind of keep free time available? Before we switch in, I want to know how you're spending your free time. But any other kind of last tips or things that have really saved you time?
Well, one of the things that I noticed when I was wasting a lot of time was that I was basically doing what a lot of people do, where you work super long hours and you put in like a 14-hour workday. You know, over time, you're less and less effective because you're tired, you're distracted, and you feel like you put in a long workday. But in reality, the amount of work you did probably could have gotten done in 6 hours instead of 14. And so a lot of what I've done now is I have not just blocks of time where I work, but I want to make sure that I build in time for exercise every single day to give me the energy that I then apply to a shorter, you know, work block in the day. And so if I have those two things kind of juxtaposed every day with, you know, a workout plan and then a highly effective 5 to 6 hour work block, that's all I need to make sure that I have the energy and creativity to get the work done. And I don't want to ever find myself back in that time frame of 12 to 14 hour work days, because they just are not effective. And ultimately, they just burn me out and make me tired and bitter. And I'm not trying to achieve that. I want to feel energized on top of my game. And I know that the healthier I am, the more energy I then have to apply to my work.
I love that. I love that, because I think there's a misconception, or maybe it's just a misintention of particularly young men, but young people in general, who think that the idea behind being more productive and more effective is to get more work done. So it's like, if I can get 20 hours of work done in a 12-hour work span, you know what I mean? And it's like, yeah. Well, at what point does that actually translate into a better life for you? I think, you know, at the end of the road of everything that we talk about on this podcast, it's like where the rubber actually meets the road is, where does this actually make your life better? Okay, cool. Your diet is healthier. How does it actually impact you in a way that improves your quality of life? And with productivity, I think it's easy to go down that slippery slope, when in fact, it sounds like you and I have both come to the same conclusion. It's actually about having more time for the things that actually bring you joy. And it's cool if work brings you joy. It should bring you joy. But ultimately, there are things in life that are going to bring you a lot more joy than work.
Yes, exactly. I think for a long time, my value in life was derived from my work. And I thought that the more hours I put in, you know, the better Jeff Sanders I'll become. But in reality, I was just making myself tired. And I wasn't actually creating the space for the things that make me now what I view as kind of my best self. And so, yeah, work is still valuable. I love what I do, but I also know that it can only last for so long each day. And I need to have a cutoff time, and it needs to be effective when I do it, and then I need to stop. And I think that's the important part, is a clear, you know, ending boundary every day to say, now it's over, I'm done, and let's go kind of live my life in those other aspects that matter a lot to me.
Yeah. I mean, I think there's also two components to that. I've been thinking about this a lot lately, because I have a person on my team who's 22 years old, Brandon. People hear me talk about him a lot. And he's just so full of energy and drive and ambition. And I see a lot of my 22-year-old self in him. And there's such a difference in the level of energy and motivation and enthusiasm that he can put into work. It's a stark comparison. And so I think part of it is, as we age, especially again, us young men who are full of testosterone and want to prove ourselves, I think we become much more compassionate with ourselves. And I think we understand the long game a lot better and understand that we can't, as you said, work has to end at some point every day, and that a long, slow, steady approach. But Brendan also pointed out, and I'm curious to hear your take on this. You know, once I told him this, I said, oh, well, 10 years from now, when you're an old fart like me, you'll have a lot more compassion for yourself and you'll feel this and that and the other. And he goes, well, yeah, but also remember, you've already proven to yourself and to others what you're capable of. So there is also an element of having the luxury of sitting back and not working on Tuesdays or working till 3 p.m. every day.
Well, that's true. I mean, in a long way, it's like, you know, I've been a full-time entrepreneur now for 4 years. And prior to that, I mean, I wasn't. I had a day job. I had to pay the bills somehow, you know, and I was working super long hours in part to create the foundation that I'm now kind of resting on to a certain degree. And so, yes, I'm still hustling and working and earning money, but I have, you know, systems in place now. And I have, there's a lot of work I put in my 20s that set me up to be able to take some time off now. And so there is an element of kind of, you know, investing a lot up front and then kind of reaping those benefits later. But even when you're putting in like an upfront investment, you don't have to kill yourself in the process. And that's not helpful or healthy. And so even now, like I see myself, like, well, where will I be 10 years from now? And how do I invest time now to be better off then? And the same mentality applies. The same approach has to be there, which is I still want to create more success for me 10 years from now, but I also can't burn myself out while doing so. And so that's the game I'm always playing.
I love that. And it reminds me of another friend and podcast guest, Jason Campbell. I was hanging out with him and we were talking about, he's in the world of Chinese medicine. And we were talking about this exact thing. And I love the way that you phrased kind of like putting in the work to now harvest, because it turns out Chinese medicine has known this for years and years and years and looks at life in cycles or seasons. So in your 70s, 80s is the winter season. And in your, I believe it's like 30s to 60s or something like that, is the spring season. Because it's like all the seeds have been planted when you're young. You've done the whole look at me. You've done the fertilizing and the tending and the watering and all the things, the educating yourself and growing and all that. And now it's time to sit back and allow the seeds to sow and then to harvest them, which happens during the spring. And I thought that was such a wonderful kind of concept. And I've certainly, and it sounds like you have as well, I've certainly felt that, where it's like, okay, I worked my ass off in my 20s and even before in my case. And now it's, I'm not willing to work as hard as Gary Vaynerchuk.
Well, even someone like Gary Vaynerchuk, I mean, he's hustling like crazy and he doesn't actually have to. Like, he's definitely successful enough. He can take a pause for like a decade or more and be okay. But he's just like, he has a drive that I don't know if anybody else on earth really has besides Elon Musk, maybe. But it's just, there is a point where the too much is too much for all of us. We all have our own kind of limits. I mean, I think it's important to push to know where those limits are without breaking ourselves, but understanding kind of what your potential is, how much you can give. I think a lot of people, you know, we tend to fall on one side or the other. We either push too much and burn ourselves out, or we never push enough and have no idea how much more we can give and how much more we can produce. And so, I mean, I'm definitely on the side of pushing too hard, but I also like the idea that I've pushed hard enough to know what my limits are so I can give as much as is beneficial and then be able to back off when need be. And so that kind of self-awareness piece is a big part of it. And I think that's what my 20s were really all about, was figuring out where my limits were and being able to take advantage of those.
I love that. I love that. So tell me, besides changing diapers, how you are spending your hard-won free time.
Well, in the last probably, let's call it 6 months or so, I started taking up woodworking as a hobby for a couple of reasons. One is that my dad and brother have always done a lot of that kind of stuff. And so my family likes to build things. I never really have. And so what I wanted to do was to have things that I could do when I wasn't working that was the opposite of work. So for me, working means being on the computer. It means being digitally connected all the time. I wanted an activity that was just totally offline. And so I go to my garage now and I build stuff. And I don't even care what it is, really. I just want to make things and use my hands and get dirty and bang hammers. And like, that's what I do now in my free time. And it is incredibly beneficial and so rewarding. partly because as a productivity guy, I mean, I like to have a checklist and I like to see kind of an end result of the work that I put in. And the cool part about this hobby is that I get an end result. I have a thing I get to use or play with or whatever it is I've built. And I really enjoy that creative process. And it's just so different from what I spend my days doing with my work that it feels like this reward to be able to go to my garage and build something. And so now to me, like going to Home Depot to buy, you know, the next set of nails or whatever, that's awesome. Like I'm like the total, like, you know, suburban dork in that sense. But like, that's what brings me joy when I'm not working.
I love that. I feel the same way. And that's like one of my biggest complaints about living in the middle of a city is it's like, I don't have a workshop. I just cannot swing having a workshop in the middle of my apartment.
Yeah, that was one benefit I got when my wife and I bought a house about 4 years ago. It was one thing I didn't think I would actually care about. I remember my realtor asked me this. She was like, Jeff, are you a handyman? I was like, no. I don't fix things. I don't build things. I just call people and they do it for me. Like that was my entire attitude. But that's changed dramatically in the last 4 years. Now I'm Mr. Fix-It in a lot of ways. And it's become a bigger part of who I am. And a part that I'm really excited to kind of explore more of because it's just a new aspect of my abilities and talents. And it's really fun to go explore that. And for me, it's kind of the next frontier in terms of, you know, doing something different that I haven't done before. And I find that really rewarding.
I love that. And I mean, I think, again, someone who has a misunderstanding of productivity might be like, really? Like, you're going to waste your time doing that? But it's totally different. And again, I feel the same way. I built my whole recording studio with my hands. I enjoyed building the recording studio more than I enjoy being in it. And I enjoy being in it quite a bit. So I love that. I love that. What else are you doing to fill your time now that, I mean, I guess I should ask, how much time did you free up? You said you were working 14-hour days before. What's your work schedule looking like these days?
What my goal generally is kind of, it's similar to what I've heard before is Tim Ferriss's, you know, 4-hour work week. There's a book out that I have not read yet that I probably should called The 5-Hour Work Day, which is essentially what I've kind of moved to. So I realized this writing my last book actually was that I would go and have these big long writing sessions and I could usually get a lot of creative energy out in between 4 to 6 hours. And by the time that time frame was up, like I was too mentally burned out to write well there anymore. And so I would shoot for, let's do 4 solid hours, write as much as I can, and then just stop the day. And that has carried over into my workday now where I've realized that if I can put in between 4 and 6 really solid focused hours, I can get a lot of work done and feel really good about my time being spent in that sense without me having to kind of drag that time out for the entire day. Part of the reality now, though, is because I have a new daughter. We have, you know, daycare in the morning, daycare in the evening. There's a lot of new routines. There's a lot of bath times and all kinds of stuff going on that never was there before. So my time is automatically a little bit shrunk because of that. But it also fits really well with just the reality that I don't want to work more than the 6 hours. I want to put in quality time and be done. And so for me, that's what I'm shooting for, is figure out what matters most today, do it in a short period of time, and then stop.
Brilliant. Again, I see completely eye to eye with you, and I try typically to start work at 9 and be out of there by like 3-4 o'clock for exactly that reason.
Yeah, and that's worked out well for me, I think, just to figure out, you know, what are the core things that need to happen and how fast can I get them done? And when I know what matters and I do it quickly and do it well, like that's enough. And the day can be over at that point. I don't have to then fill the rest of the time with just more activity. I can feel confident that if I knew what mattered and I got it done and the day is over at noon, fine, it's over at noon. I move on. Like I don't want to just be busy for the sake of being busy, which was my old attitude and one that didn't serve me well. So from here on out, that's not the case.
I love that. What's some homework that we can give, Jeff, to our audience to help them either eliminate something or get some more time back? I'd love to give people an actionable takeaway.
I think what really helped me a lot and something that I frequently do is a time audit. And so I will just do a full breakdown of, you know, what did yesterday look like? What did I actually do? And then based on that, like what was stupid about my time usage? Like what was not necessary? What could I indefinitely not do in the future? And the more things I can recognize that don't matter, that I can let go of, the more time that is then freed up. And then one of my core things I've done for years is whenever I do free up new time, I want to intentionally optimize that time with something that I have not been spending time on. So let's say, for example, a simple one here, you cut an hour out of your workday that you used to waste on something that you didn't have to do. Well, now take that hour and do something with it. Like, use it wisely. You know, do some yoga for an hour, read a book for an hour, take a nap for an hour. Like, fill it with something that you are missing out on that would replenish you, that would make you feel better, that would make you healthier. But make that swap and do so with an intentionality behind it that usually wouldn't happen. Because for most people, if they cut an hour out of their schedule, the time just naturally fills in with more nonsense or more stuff or more work. But that doesn't serve the grander purpose of you're cutting something for a reason. Now go fill that space with something that really matters to you. And then you'll see the benefit. And you'll be like, oh, wow, I free up an hour. I got that hour to do an activity I loved. Now I want to do that again. How can I free up more time? How can I craft more of my schedule to be more like the day I want to live? And then
totally.
That, for me, I mean, so excited that because I was like, this is the life I want. Let's do more of that.
Totally. And I'm really glad you're saying that because I have certainly in the past been guilty of, you know, leaving the office at 3 o'clock and then just kind of wasting away the rest of the day. It's so easy to turn on a movie while you start tidying up the house and then you finish tidying the house and you leave the movie running. And before you know it, it's 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock at night. And you really do have to be that deliberate and even to the extent of putting things into the calendar. So instead of going straight from the office home, going to that yoga lesson or that Russian tutor, because otherwise, you know, time just slips through your fingers so quickly if you're not deliberate about how you're spending it.
Yeah, it's amazing to me just how often we think that we have, you know, no time at all. But then when time does actually show up, we squander it. Like, it doesn't get utilized the way that it could. And so the more awareness you have about what your tendencies are, how you tend to fill your time, you can then catch yourself when you're wasting time and be able to stop yourself in the moment and shift gears. And for me, that's been really helpful because I know that, you know, we all have certain tendencies of things that we do just because we've always done them. If you catch yourself in that habit, you can stop and then change to something better. And that in a daily basis, you can utilize that strategy and free up a lot of time right there.
I love that. I love that. Well, Jeff, I know you're the productivity guru and whiz, and you fought hard to have the free time to have this call. So I want to give you an opportunity to give people your details and let them know where they can connect with you before I let you go.
Well, yeah, I appreciate that. My website is jeffsanders.com. That's the home base to find my podcast, The 5 a.m. Miracle. I have two books. The first one is called The 5 a.m. Miracle as well. And the second one, The Free Time Formula. So those are kind of the big things to know about me. You can learn a whole lot of other things I teach from that location. So yeah, jeffsanders.com.
Awesome. And you've been very busy. You've launched a productivity academy with all kinds of courses and interviews and check-ins and stuff like that. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, 2 years ago, I launched the Rockin' Productivity Academy, and I do those things you just mentioned. I've got training videos on there with all kinds of productivity tips, lots of exclusive interviews with high achievers, custom monthly coaching check-ins with me. So if you want to get kind of feedback on your goals you're working on now, that's built into it as well. So that was really created for people who are high achievers that just want to figure out kind of how to do what we discussed today, like figuring out what's not working and how to correct those mistakes so you can get more out of your time.
I love that. Awesome. Well, Jeff, I really hope we do keep in touch. I want to thank you so much for sharing your very precious time with us today. I really enjoyed our conversation, and I know our audience did as well.
Great. Thanks a lot.
Take care, my friend.
All right, super friends, that is all we have for you today. But I hope you guys really enjoyed the show, and I hope you learned a ton of actionable information, tips, advice that will help you go out there and overcome the impossible. If you've enjoyed the show, please take a moment to leave us a review on iTunes or Stitcher, or drop us a quick little note on the Twitter machine at GoSuperHuman. Also, if you have any ideas for anyone out there who you would love to see on the show, we always love to hear your recommendations. You can submit on our website or you can just drop us an email and let us know. That's all for today, guys. Thanks for tuning in.
Thanks for tuning in to the Becoming Superhuman podcast. For more great skills and strategies, or for links to any of the resources mentioned in this episode, visit www.becomingasuperhuman.com/podcast. We'll see you next time.